We now move on to the track on procurement. We will now discuss on how we can develop our sourcing strategies in a disruptive environment. In the panel, I have a very eclectic bunch of professionals, starting with Ashish Bansal, Head India Procurement at Colgate-Palmolive Limited. Ashish, Shom Chatterjee, Chairman Agriculture and Food Processing at ITC Limited. Swapneel Bhat, Director Continuous Improvement and Indirect Procurement at Cipla. Kalpesh, Senior Vice President at Fiat Chrysler Automobiles. Manish, Bhasin, Managing Director Maersk Procurement at AP Moller Maersk. Ashish Tripathi, Head of Strategic Sourcing and Logistics and Agency at TORM Shipping. And the moderator of the session would be Radha Mohan Gupta, Regional Procurement Director, South Asia at Reckitt, Benckiser. The panel is all yours.
The session is going to be heavy, right after the, especially the lunch, but thanks to Venom who took the load, first load of, starting it after lunch. But let me assure you that we will not let you sleep. That's our guarantee, right? I mean, panel members are over here. Since morning, guys, we have been talking about the change which is coming into supply chain, right? It is going to digitization, automation is happening, and people are also even, scaring you by saying that it's an era of disruption which is coming in, right? So there are so much of changes which are happening into supply chain. Let me tell you, nothing to worry, right? We have come from the age when we were, somebody told that we were pulling the cart and the material was still reaching to our rural areas, right? Nothing to worry, because we as the requirements are going up, I know you and me are continuously developing the systems, processes, and also the supply chain, which should be supporting the change which are coming in, right? Now, if you see the changes which are happening, it's happening. And in my, wherever I go, I always talk about that it's happening everywhere. I think without, if change is not happening, I think it's a death. Certainly there's nothing happening over there. So change has to happen. And we must be thanking that these changes are happening in our life, kind of thing. The consumer is changing. I always start with consumer. He's changing. His loyalty is changing, kind of thing. The products are changing, right? The product which were monopoly, kind of thing. You cannot now imagine that a product will remain monopolist for long. There's another product which comes in, and then the competition is always there, and you are changing the product, kind of thing, over there. Now, how the supply chain has been supporting it? If somebody talked about just now, that supply chain is being used as the competitive edge, right? Now, it is certainly, if you see, you take example of any e-commerce company, or you take example of any FMCG companies, kind of thing. If something is giving them an edge over other competition, it is supply chain, be it speed to market. Now, it's not only the marketing colleagues who are talking about speed to market. It is also even end of the supply chain, which is procurement, the starting one, sourcing. They are talking about speed to market. If your suppliers are flexible, if your supplier are capable, right, you will be better able to, and fast, you will be able to reach the market faster. So supply chain is giving you all kind of competitive edge. And as I keep saying, that it is really a weapon. Not only the strategy, not only the edge, but it's a weapon which you develop over a time in your organizations to give you that competitive edge over others, kind of thing. And when we are talking about supply chain is changing, supply chain is developing, and 4.0 and 5.0 and whatnot, procurement is also part of supply chain. And when supply chain is changing, of course, procurement has to change. And that's how in this panel we are going to discuss that how the procurement role has been changing, right from traditional role, which was focused on availability and cost, to entirely differently. Now tell me, how many of us, as of now, in procurement are talking about cost and quality? They are the most important one, but how many of us are focusing on this one? Because we keep it as given now. I take it as granted that that is the supplier's job to give me. Right, the cost has to be competitive, quality has to be there. That is the minimum thing which they can offer me. And now come on the table to discuss about what else we require. right? So procurement role also has changed, right from the sourcing, not only for sourcing, but also giving the value to the business. And these values could be innovations which come from your supplier side, because you are a marketing company, maybe perhaps they are the manufacturing and they know in the deep what they are manufacturing and where they can provide you the edge. So the innovation is coming. Your networking capital management, that is coming from why you are working with them. So your synchronization of procurement strategy is now coming much and much with the business strategy, and you are getting closer to your sales system as well. Now you can see that there are two functions which have lot many interaction with external world. One side it is sales, certainly, which is dealing with the external world, and second side is your procurement, which is having the entire world of the suppliers with whom they are dealing with and trying to supply you at the cost advantage kind of thing. We have the eminent panelist over here to discuss this. Manish. Ashish, sorry. We have the panelists over here. We would like to discuss some of these parameters. I know it's a very vast subject. We'll try to touch upon some of the, these parameters over here, the how the procurement is changing and how we are trying to support the entire business into this one. So in this process, first of all, I would like to ask Ashish Tripathi that when we are doing these all kind of changes, right? Whenever we think of procurement, first thing comes in mind is suppliers, right? So how these suppliers are helping us in terms of the social and economic changes which are happening to support the business and add value.
Thank you for the question.
You
invited to be part of this panel first. So I'll talk about a little bit on the upper of the value chain, because I'm representing the say, shipping companies as such. So I know we have panelists from retail, pharma, auto. I put across my challenge and how we try to address that. Because if you see two sides on that, first is on the social part of it. So gone are the time where it was just for the sake of doing it. Now, I mean, you know it better. So there is actually a value creation in that part, which is the social part of it. And also, how do you justify? Because being a procurement professional, it is really easy to pull out some number. I saved a million, but where is that on the bottom line? So that still remains a quite much of a challenge to really prove that it has made an impact to us. So talking about challenges, what we face, so to not use as a jargon, but say supplier empowerment, it's a quite heavy word there. But irrespective of industries, what I believe, what we need to think as a leaders in our segments is, how are we ensuring that we pay the vendor or suppliers on time? Somebody, I think Praful was talking about blockchain, and there was a bit which was talking, and that is something we can go back to the board and start looking that how do we ensure that we pay them on time? And once we have that as a basic thing in place, I'm sure they will be like a extended arm of your company. So peculiar challenge, I'll talk about two examples and then we'll move on to the next part is, we call about 600 different ports globally, and part of my team looks after to ensure the last mile delivery. So you can't be really present across 600 different ports. You need to have an agent, and you have different customers, say like British Petroleum, Shell, Chevron, which will be visiting your vessel for technical. You have your own crew joining. You have your spares being connected. So a lot of gamut of operations are going on. So in order to do that, you need to have somebody whom you can trust. Working capital comes as a bigger challenge. So we talk to the agents all across is that you don't worry about the payment. We'll take care of that. And because of the bureaucracy, red tape, or whatever you call it, internally, which we have, sometimes we hamper that. So once you take care of that, that is going to happen that they work on your behalf, like I said, they be your extended arm. So, and that we have seen gradually once you tell that, because we are talking different geographies, different nationalities, different cultures, so that becomes a challenge. But across payment on time, and then you talk about next. Second example on the social part of it, shipping is being said that we contribute about 10% in terms of greenhouse gas emission impact. And if you've been following news recently, there was the 16-year-old girl from Sweden, Greta Thunberg, who was all over the place in New York Council. UN Council. So what we have pledged that by 2030 we reduce our foothold emissions by 50% and by 2050 it becomes carbon neutral. So it is a very bold statement to make for a company which transports a crude oil or crude oil petroleum, how you really become carbon neutral by 2050. And it is not, the technology is not there, so for that to happen, the ships has to be in the fleet by 2030 and entire range of issues. And that is where the supplier comes into picture, which are been helping to develop the technology. It is a trial and error manner. How do you address that you still provide value to your investors? Because at the end of the day, you can talk quite rosy picture, but at the end of the day, investors are on top of you to ensure that you generate money or value to them. So that is where we have seen that if we come across with the various suppliers and then tell them this is the issues, because they are dealing with like your own company, many other such companies, and they can tell you very easily that this is right probably, which you can address, or this is something better you are doing, or you can improve on that part. So I think that is once the bottom line remains to me, you have your payment terms worked out, you pay them on time, and of course they will act on like an extended arm for you.
Thank you, Ashish, for your views on social, especially the social part of this, which you touched upon. Thank you very much. Now coming to, I think we have been hearing about the artificial intelligence and the digitization, etc. So Manish, would you like to speak about that, how it is changing the procurement processes and how it is making the procurement even more competitive?
Thank you, Radha ji, and pleasure to be here in the panel and also with all of you. So on the use of artificial intelligence and robotics, and then we've been seeing a lot of presentations on that one related to supply chain, but at least I can share with you in a very tangible manner how the world of strategic sourcing is changing as far as robotics and automation is concerned. So we have developed, we have right now in the office where I work in Bhawai, we have about 200 employees doing procurement for AP Moller Maersk globally. And I also like to say we don't have 220, we have 223, because we have three robots also. So there are three algorithms who work 24 hours, 7 days a week. And one of the robots, and I must admit it's not very stable yet, so they do break down sometimes. But at least one of the robots has just completed or has managed to structure a fully automated e-auction. So it actually picks up the data from the ERP, feeds it in, builds scenarios, selects which format of the auction to work in, and then basically we run a fully automated e-auction. So we ran that for a couple of our categories. It was very successful. But the interesting part that I at least thought maybe it'd be a little bit of humble inspiration is that we've recently, I can't name the supplier for confidential reasons, but one of our suppliers has also developed a bot to participate in e-auctions. So we will soon, and I'm very excited to see this, be envisioning a bot-to-bot e-auction happening. And that's going to be interesting to see who wins that one, because it's a battle of the data scientists and the people who build the algorithms. So it's still in nascent stages. It's going to take a few years to stabilize it, obviously. But that's where the world is headed, and that is where we as professionals need to adapt. Now, what is happening as a result of this, at least what I'm noticing, are two consequences. Number one, as more and more digital and automation starts taking effect, as the algorithms become stronger, as the years progress, and they will, there's no doubt about that, we are going to face a challenge on talent management, on talent retention, and on basically what sort of a vision do we give to young people entering or who want to enter the world of procurement. And that is where there is a very proactive need in the procurement community to actually start thinking very, very seriously about upskilling. It's a buzzword and it's in newspapers and it's in the press, but it's only a matter of time before it's going to hit functions like procurement, HR and finance very, very seriously. Jobs are not going to go away. Jobs are just going to change. The nature of the jobs is going to change. So today, If we are in a position to do robot-to-robot e-auctions, then the strategic sourcing team needs to move on to doing supplier serious supplier negotiations, supplier innovations, seriously partnering with the suppliers to bring about new ways of creating value. That is where, you know, that's the direction where talent management also needs to head. The second aspect is that the use of technology cannot be ignored, because I still get a lot of cases where, you know, a sourcing manager will say that, like, the supplier, you know, he doesn't have internet and we can't do this and we can't do that. Well, if he doesn't have internet, then you better get him to have internet. Because the point is that we cannot drive any form of end-to-end digitization without, or rather with having data in Excel sheets or on desktops and dependent on people who kind of change jobs every 2 years. We need data on a data lake of some kind. So an ERFQ or an ERFP or an e-auction is necessary to us, not only from a pure cost-saving standpoint, but also to ensure that all the data comes in a reservoir from where we can tap into it and evolve an end-to-end ecosystem. So, you know, we can't, in today's day and age, I really like the previous presentation, which said that, you know, you need to move away from the desktop and it's on your phone. The excuse of not having internet is passe. So if you don't have internet, you better learn to use it or get your son to use it for you or do something like that. So that's at least a little bit of how we see it, and then it's sourcing, but then it also links, of course, to supply chain. We have the remaining two robots working in our supply chain team processing POs. We haven't given them approval rights yet; that we've still kept manual. But at least the PO processing and so on is happening completely robotized. And in fact, we also changed the designation of one of our supply chain managers recently. We started calling him virtual workforce manager, because that's where we see the world headed. We actually will see managers managing robots, you know, not just people. So that's that would be my take on it.
Thank you very much, Manish, for the insights. And you know, as generally there have been, you mentioned that robots are working 24/7 kind of thing. I'm sure, like labor laws, soon the robot laws will also come. You can't exploit them. Now, but other than that, I think what Manish mentioned very, very, I think we should highlight once again is the talent management, which is required now with the changing scenario. And second thing is in terms of the data reservoir. I think that's again a very important point, that technology is required for the data reservoir, as it used to be, you know, to be used as data reservoir, or it works as a data reservoir as well, which is a really added advantage to that. Thank you, Manish, once again. Right. Now, while we all are the procurement professionals over here, but I think it's a very heterogeneous group of different industries, I will put up the same question for AI and digitization. It needs certainly some more discussion. I'll put the same question that how it is changing in FMCG world, Ashish, who is from Colgate-Palmolive.
Thanks, Radha. And examples like Manish said, these are something which definitely not scares, but suddenly eye opens, and all of us in this room, that what's going to be our job probably a year or 2 years down the line. But, and I think that's the premise, and this is the certainty which is going to come in terms of that the digital transformation is going to stay. The key question is, it's not even a choice. It's a question about how soon you start adapting it. I think the way the industry is moving it is, and I think I like the previous presentation, and it's getting into five different buckets. So in the past, what used to happen is, number one, each department will start having its own data. And everyone will start working on this data that, okay, I like the supplier because, okay, I like him. Now today, why do you like a supplier? Why do you want, what do you mean by performance? All this information is getting more and more into a cloud. So everyone is getting an access to the same level of information, what you do. And then how do you start making a collective decision out of it? So that's the one fundamental change that is coming in, that the information is becoming more of a commonly shared commodity, if you say. And number two is that how do you start now leveraging that data and starting using of data analytics? And I think that's where what Manish talked about, that how do you start looking at your role? So I think the job, which used to be something about sending out an extension letters, I'm sending out a regular letter. All these jobs are becoming more and more automated. So today you have cloud technologies which can publish, make the customized letters, make out customized emails, and they pushes it out. So then the job that starts becoming to us as leaders and our teams is that then how do we start customizing our team to the idea that now how do you start progressing from a one step ahead and thinking beyond what you had been doing? So that's the other piece to start working in from a supply chain point of view. And then the third piece comes in from a customer and the whole analytics. Now, while we are doing the same data, I think our customers, our extended supply chain is today mining the same data. Now the question is this, that how do you be in the first in the race, or how do you start understanding that what is the data which your customers and consumers are today showing, how do you start getting that data? And then, and that is where then another scope which is moving in is from a traditional FMCG space, it is becoming a more customized products. It's also becoming a space where your products will start getting more of a usage data from your consumers, and that is what is getting feeded into us. And I, the last mile still probably I'll say in early days for the plants and supply chain to start working. But then tomorrow, how do you start connecting that data to your supply chain, and then your manufacturing moving out from the traditional batch-based manufacturing to more of a customized unit-based manufacturing. And I think those are the few dimensions. So how do you start having a common data map? How do you have your team starting analyzing that data? Then how do you start getting the data, more of data feed from your customers, and then start re-energizing, re-engineering your entire supply chain to that customized requirements? That's going to be the theme. And I think this is why we think probably it might take 5 years, but the way things are progressing probably might be sooner. So I think the more we start moving to a space, I think one of the great examples when you said rethinking about the designations, but more important is rethinking and re-scaling our teams in terms of the skills that we need. And I think this is, and this has to start from all of us, because I think A, we have ourselves not seen that change, that what does then our job starts becoming into that domain? And how do we migrate to this and adapt to it? I think that's going to be a whole set of digital transformation that we will see very soon.
I think one of the things which he mentions that there is no choice left. The choice only you have is how soon we can adopt to these changes which are happening. And there is a plethora of data, and the, you know, is coming in, tsunami of data coming in. How to utilize it in your favor, and in time, and how soon is the thing which we are, you know, we need to look at. Okay, coming to now, I think whenever we are talking about procurement, the focus remains generally on the direct dispense, right? The raw material, packing material, etc. The hidden thing which remains is the non-production spend, right? Which is lots of spend goes over there as well, and when you get into the details in devil, as they say, the devil is in details. They say when you go into the detail, you find there's a lot of opportunity to save a lot of money over there. So Swapneel is from that area, and I want to understand from him that how to focus on indirect spends so that we add business, add value to business, and don't keep it as a neglected area.
So, very thankful for the question, and indirect procurement typically is I've heard various names for indirect procurement, miscellaneous purchases, OPEX spend, and not neglected, but it is often an area where the focus of the management does not kind of get to the details of the whole process. Most of the categories that we handle, the problems that we face, a huge amount of transactions, it is completely, what do you call it? It is broken down into singular transactions. We do not have continuity and various business users. So it really is a challenge in terms of how do you develop it into a value generator for the organization. Now, having said that, I think it's an easier statement to make that you start becoming a strategic business partner to the management, but it's actually a stepwise or a stage-wise process, as I would say. Primary aspect of indirect procurement is to understand the various categories of spends that is being handled by the teams, and then identify what are the transactional activities that happen. So these are two areas where we see technology playing a significant role. We have various technology answers towards automating transactions. We heard some in terms of robotics, e-buying, e-sourcing, catalog-based procurement. I think those are the basics which we should be already looking at or already deploying to stabilize our indirect procurement. Once we've got a hand or handle on the category management model and the technology for transaction-based activities, that's when we start looking upwards in terms of looking at supplier performance and risk management. That's the second aspect where indirect procurement can add a lot of value. How do we set up our metrics and measurements around suppliers' performance? What are the parameters that we're looking at from a risk perspective to mitigate the challenges that you would face from suppliers? Once you've kind of stabilized that aspect, then comes the third part where you actually step into being a strategic partner. And when I talk about being a strategic partner is to start looking at strategic considerations from a procurement standpoint. So things like demand management. Now, this is something which is very common from the direct procurement standpoint because most of the things are through the planning and MRP processes and so on. Whereas from an indirect standpoint, you rarely have a line item level budget. And that's where demand management comes in handy when you start engaging early with the business users to understand what kind of spends they are planning for doing. The initiatives around costs which can be looked at, something like make versus buy, buying versus leasing, insourcing versus outsourcing. So these are a few of the strategic considerations which the indirect procurement can start pushing, and that's where the value for the business can come.
Thank you, Swapneel, for giving some of the things. And again, what you mentioned is that it's getting the details and then, you know, converting that data into the information, bisecting into the details and then acting upon that. Thank you very much. One of the trends which you see, I think, and that is also changing the procurement as a function, is that if you see the blue molders, right, what's happening? What's happening over there in the blue molding industry? What is happening in the food industry? What's happening into the auto industry? One thing which you will find, which is common, is the consolidation. Right? People are coming together, the small partners are coming together, and they are trying to make it a bigger farm kind of thing. And there's a lot of consolidation is happening. Now, this consolidation is also impacting your entire processes which are there into the supply chain. I would invite Mr. Kalpesh, who is from FCA, to talk about that, how this consolidation is impacting the entire procurement.
Thanks, Radha. Okay, let me just start with the macro view and then probably try to develop analogy to explain the whole concept of value generation, what auto industry thinks of. Now, most of you, I think, auto industry related news are like news are well read by all of you. So, I think all of you know that auto industry is at one of the biggest cusp of transformation. And I'm not talking only India, but I'm talking globally, which all of you are aware of. Now, there are like four like words which globally in auto industry people talk about, correct? ACs. So first, A is autonomous, C is connected, E is electrification, and S is shared mobility. Now, around these four words, correct, I think a lot of planning today auto industry does to see that in the times to come, we are able to generate the best value for our customers. Now, since morning, I think all of us are hearing about like planning, technology, geography. Let me go one by one, like when it comes to planning. Now, few of you would have, or most of you are aware that my company, correct, 2009, Chrysler was on the verge of bankruptcy, and Fiat from Italy purchased that company and made one entity called Fiat Chrysler. What was that? I think consolidation. Why it was required? One company was dying, another company was not doing well. And today, I think we know like within 3 hours, in 2013, Mr. Sergio Marchionne declared the turnaround of FCA. How that has happened, I think most of you have read, but I'll just try to draw the corollary and then come to the details. Now, few days back, I think all of you would have read that now FCA and PSA of France have declared, both the boards have declared that both the companies they would like to merge. why this is happening. I think this is happening to generate the value for the future customer, because auto industry, the kind of transformation which it is seeing, the kind of technology, the speed at which it is changing, unless there is a consolidation, we are not able to or will not be able to generate the value for our customers. Now let me just give you one data point. Like, we all talk about electric in India, and last year like three manufacturers launched electric vehicle. Like, we know the cost of Hyundai Kona, how much does it cost? Around 25 lakhs, correct? And the conventional same car, Hyundai Kona is nothing but it's a typical i20, correct? And i20 is costing around 10 lakhs. So it's 150 times more expensive, correct? Now, suppose if we are all doing that for the environmental concerns and the energy security, we have no other choice but to go to electric vehicle. Are our customers, like today with the conventional IC engine, technology, we have 3 million customers in India. With 2.5 million cost of Hyundai Kona, which equivalent IC engine counterpart is like 10 lakhs rupees, are we going to fulfill the customer expectation? No. So now if we have to, correct, meet the expectation of the customer, to see that we bring down the cost of electric technology and able to price the vehicles at the same price or cheaper than that, we will not be able to serve our customers. So I think that's the kind of core theme, and I just draw the corollary back to the planning process, that globally you see, if we have to generate the value for our customers through the procurement process, at macro level companies are planning, like Fiat Chrysler merger I talked about, FCA and PSA merger I'm talking about, most of you know about, like Suzuki and Toyota have a like partnership in India. What is this? Renault and Nissan, which has been working successfully. So at macro level, I think the companies are trying to consolidate to generate the value, because effectively when you consolidate, it helps you to generate the value in your procurement process. Now talking about the technology, let me just draw a corollary. Like in typical automotive industry, like prototyping is very, very important activity where we go for any new product development. Like with the technology coming in, like 3D printing, see, when we were earlier developing the products, and I'm talking about 10 years back, the normal product development life cycle was like 36 to 48 months. And when I say product development, right from conceiving the product to launching in the market, not the adaptation that we have a particular product available in the global markets and we bring it, but what I was talking broadly about 36 to 48 months. Now with the 3D printing coming in, that development cycle is reduced like from 24 to 36 months. So huge benefit. So that also helps us to generate the value for our customers, because once the development lead time is gone down, definitely is able to help us to reduce some of our costs, which is able to help us deliver the values. And geography, let me just tell you, like the consolidation, same example I'm talking about, like the latest one I'll pick, our company and PSA. Now you know the markets are changing, and some companies are strong in particular regions, some companies are little bit weaker in particular region. Now, unless we have a homogeneous kind of customer base, okay, in product like ours, to deliver the efficient supply chain is not going to be easy. So that is also one of the reason the companies are using the consolidation strategy. Like FCA is very strong in like Latin America and North America. Equally strong both companies in EMEA. APEC is a challenge, but again when we come together, definitely we see a synergy. So that's what. Now I just link this corollary back to like dynamic value network, which Paul was just mentioning. What has happened in auto industry, most of you know that earlier when we are developing any product, the life cycle was 8 to 10 years. Today it is hardly 4 years. Now with the kind of technology which is going to come, like in electric, let me just give you an example. Today we talk about lithium ion. But lithium ion would run for next 20 years? No, for sure. Because there are a lot of research going on other, like we call it advanced chemistry batteries. Now, suppose if lithium ion goes away in, let's say, 2 years or 3 years, we don't know, because the way the whole world is researching, so will we be able to recover the cost or investments which we are making for lithium ion? That's also another bigger challenge. And that's where, now since the life cycles are coming down, technology is changing very fast, correct? And the market geography is like the geopolitical situation, like in auto industry, if you look at the material cost, correct, out of 100 rupees, 30 to 35 rupees are controlled by petroleum-based products in conventional automotive. Now with the kind of petroleum prices, you know, they are like more driven by the geopolitical situation, and we don't know when it will change. And it is very, very important that we need some stability at least for 6 months to 1 year kind of scenario to at least plan anything and like do our pricing and serve the particular market. That's not possible. So what are the alternates? I think the whole industry right now, the kind of transformation which it is seeing, I feel consolidation, especially in auto industry, is going to help a lot to generate the value for the business. And with the kind of fast changing the technology, we'll be able to dynamically align, correct, from the in the changing times.
I think a very detailed view on auto industry, especially. Thank you very much for your this. Now, coming to whenever we are talking about, I think, in supply chain also, and we have been partners to, you know, in sustainability. It's a subject which is being discussed everywhere and in detail kind of thing. Right? Now, being part of supply chain, we can ensure that this sustainability issue gets addressed right at the sourcing point, right? So that we have the right importance given to this very, very critical subject. I would invite Shom to talk about it, that how, what we do or what procurement is doing so that we ensure that this critical issue gets addressed right at the sourcing point itself.
Thank you, Mr. Gupta. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I can see that there are a few seats vacant, and probably to liven up this session, I will not give you GAM. I will tell you a story. Okay, but before I tell you the story, I am very proud to represent ITC, which is probably the only company of its size today in India, which is completely water and carbon positive, right? So we are, so if you stay in ITC hotel, you're actually replenishing the environment. If you buy one of our products, you are actually helping the environment, and I'll explain to you how that works. Thank you. It's been a lot of sustained and strategy to do that. But while we are doing sustainability, the one fundamental tenet that we always follow is that this is not a soup kitchen, this is not a charity. So while we are doing this, it should also make us money. It should be a win-win. And today I'm going to tell you the story of one of our leading products, Ashirvad Atta. So how many of you in this room are consumers of Ashirvad Atta? And oh yeah, that's very heartening to see, probably most of the room now. We at ITC Foods entered the foods business pre-link when the space was already occupied by multinationals and very large corporates. For instance, we'll stick to the Atta story here. So when we came into the business, we were faced with a lot of local players like Lakshmi Bhog and Shakti Bhog, etc. But there were two big elephants in the room. There was Annapurna from Levers, and there was Pillsbury from General Mills. And these guys were deep pockets. They had a lot of R&D, and they had a lot of distribution muscle. When we entered the Ashirvad Atta business, we never ever in our wildest dreams imagined that this product will get us market salience almost close to what we have in our another big business, which is tobacco. In tobacco, we are like 84% of the market, and in Atta today, we packaged Atta, we are about that kind of percentage. This transformation is the story, and how sustainability ties into this. Now, it's not that Annapurna had a bad product, or Pillsbury product is bad, they're pretty good. But there was some fundamental supply chain understanding flaw, which we saw that gap and we filled it. So before I explain that, and I tell you what is the secret to the successful and the much loved Ashirvad Atta, Can anyone in this room, it's a small trivia, how many different varieties of wheat do you think exists in the world? Any number? Well, you'd be surprised to know, 753 varieties, okay? And in India alone, 40 such varieties exists and are actively grown by the farmers. The conundrum is that the farmer often doesn't even know what he's growing, except for some very premium varieties like Sharbati and Lokwan, where he has to pay higher for the seed itself, seed wheat. The others, he doesn't know what he's planting. And therefore, when my colleagues at Pillsbury or Annapurna were making their atta, it's not that they were buying bad wheat, they were buying good quality wheat. But they just didn't have any control on what wheat they were buying. And why is that important? It's important because these 40 varieties which are grown in India, not all of them, but I would say at least 15 varieties, if I were to make garam roti for you, I grind the varieties fresh in front of you, make garam roti and feed it to you blindfolded, even you will be able to make out the difference between those 15 varieties. Some will be harder, some will be softer, some will be sweeter, some will have more of a stressability, and so on and so forth. And we also, our research showed that the tastes in India can change every 500 kilometers. So preferences, so the housewife in Delhi, she likes a very different kind of atta, at quality and sensorial attribute to the one in Calcutta, for instance. And therefore, we actually created geographical blends and we identified those wheat varieties which could make them. Now, obviously, I will not tell you the varieties of wheat which we use to make the different blends, that's the secret. However, here is where sustainability and supply chain comes in. So what we did was, we used our Eachopal, and I don't know if, I'm sure many of you who are students of supply chain will have read about it, it's a Harvard case study. It's basically a direct farmer connect program. So what we did was, we connected with the farmers at the village levels, at the mandi level, and we were able to identify, when he brought in the wheat, at that stage we were able to identify which is the variety. And we bought it from him, and if it's a better variety, we even paid him a premium. So that's the way we encouraged the farmer, we helped him with his income. And in our case, we were able to segregate and store that variety. And we used our extensive network of supply chain to get it to the different locations and blend it. So the result of this exercise is that while the buyer at Hindustan Lever is buying good wheat, but he doesn't really have a control on which lot is which variety. So every manufacturing batch can technically be different from the last one. And our success, and why you all love Ashirwad Atta so much, is the fact that it's consistent. Roti after roti, month after month, it's the same taste. And that is really the weight on this. Now the sustainability part. When we started working with the farmers, we realized that, hey, for us to maintain this business edge over competition, these are the main guys that we've got to work with. So we started helping them out in a lot of ways through our Reach Up Our initiative. If they required inputs, we gave them the inputs, agricultural inputs. If they required insurance, if they needed advice, if they needed soil health advice. I'm sure all of you are on smartphones. Do a quick Google on images. Just type in ITC watershed program, okay? And I think one of the first images which would get thrown up by Google would be of a nice big lake kind of a thing. There's a boat and there's a guy who's throwing a fishing net. And when you look at that image, it would be, you say to yourself, hey, this is Kerala. But you know what? That's a part of Rajasthan. And that's what we've done. So what we were able to do with satellite mapping, we were able to find out the natural water channels of various places on the topography, and we helped the local farmers in making the watershed check dams, deepening them, etc., etc. And today, we are getting our variety of wheat from these guys at a much better yield. Their farmer income are going, and they are picking up and doing the kind of varieties that we want. So that's that in short is the story of the Ashirwad Atta. But if you just allow me 30 seconds more, the story is not over. So what happens now that we make the Ashirwad Atta? We pack them in these plastic bags, right? And that's the biggest challenge today, single-use plastic, right? So are we not polluting? Yes, we are. So we did this quick math and we found that ITC as a corporate for all our FMCG and all our products, we put into the environment 26,000 tons of plastic waste every year. Okay? So 3 years back, much before it became fashionable to talk about single-use plastic, we started this program called WOW, which is well-being out of waste. And now we are operating in 17 different geographies in India. And so this NGO come business model, it's a business model. It's again, sustainability making money. Unless it makes money, you will not solve the problem, right? It has to be a win-win for all stakeholders. So what we are doing is we are already collecting 40,000 tons out of the 26,000. And by 2022, we'll be actually helping others collect their rubbish. Yeah? It's not fashionable to collect rubbish, but hey, if you've got to be sustainable, you've got to do that. And what is happening to all this plastic? We're helping, we've tied up with the NHAI. We're making roads with them. We're making highways with them. Interestingly, just a quick math, for buying bitumen, what they call, the local contractors will call damper, right? The NHAI, the contractors, actually it costs the government of India about 42 bucks kilo of damper, the bitumen. If you were to mix this plastic waste granules into that in a certain ratio, you can actually drop that cost to half. And anything above 18 rupees a kilo, and it becomes very attractive for the rat picker to pick up the trash. Yeah? So we've been able to create that value. And today it says, in fact, there is they want more rubbish. And it's a very interesting. Today, I was just seeing somewhere on the net that Netherlands is one country which has become rubbish neutral, and they are now having to import rubbish to feed their plants, which are recycling. So ultimately, we should get there. Thank you.
Telling us the real story, not the story, but the real story of ITC and some of the programs they are doing, and the WOW program which you mentioned is really WOW, right, kind of thing. I think we are running out of time, but it will be unfair if I don't ask this question, right? And I would request all the panelists members to just answer in one line, not beyond that, right? So when we are changing so rapidly, what in your opinion is one thing which Indian industry in procurement should do? Right, only one liner. So we start from Ashish.
I think for me is skill enhancement of our people.
Okay. So
technology adoption.
Yeah. I think if it's one line, then I will say two things in one line. And one I would say is definitely. I think. If I were to say it in one line, I think what's going to be very important is that in forums like these, the procurement community comes very close with each other. I think that is very, very important, because that is going to be key in digital talent management and sustainability.
Thank you. Kalpesh. Only inevitable is change, so we have to constantly change very fast.
Wonderful. I think cross-industry, there's a lot of to learn from each other. Okay, great point.
I think the point side, so things which
thank you very much. I think it was a very detailed discussion from the panel members. The guys, I'll leave you with three questions, right? We have discussed in detail, and there are many things to do. But if we can, depending on our own industry, our own company, if we can focus on, the first question I leave with you is, do we have the really right focus on the right thing? Your focus might be on different thing, or might be you might require for a different thing, and I might require for a different thing. So do we have the right focus? Number two is, do we have the right technology to support? Now there are many technologies available. Have we chosen the right technology to support the direction we want to go? And finally, I think people have talked about this, that do we have the talent to manage these all changes which are coming? With this, we end this session. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, gentlemen. Just hold a moment, please, to me felicitate you with a. We quickly break for tea, 15 minutes, back again. 4:15.